Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Expert Systems Champion by Adrian Tchaikovsky, narrated by Shaun Grindell. Prologue, The Sister Colony, Part 1. 72 hours awake and Bane wanted a crash. Lena Dahl came in just as the drugs were wearing off, complaining about the sampling drones. Gone. Another one gone. He lay there in his pod. Just another 5 minutes. Except it wouldn't be 5 minutes. 5 hours. 5 days. It felt as though he could sleep 5 weeks and still not iron the kinks out. But there weren't enough shoulders to share the load of the new colony. Everyone was farmered to the eyeballs to keep them going. It started because the days here were 2 hours too short, to go with the years, being 80 of those days too long. 2 hours short. You'd think it would be easy enough to adapt to, but nobody had. Give me a 36-hour cycle and I reckon I could have lived with it, Bane told himself. But just 2 hours too few in the day, he'd never settled. And now, Lena came stomping in, banging on his lid, just as he was about to have himself put under. I know you're not gone yet, Bane. We have to talk. Half an hour later, and he was back on the fizzy cocktail that kept them going there. All 28 of them doing the work of 50 people, trying to keep the sister expedition going with practically zero support from the ship. He was back in the ready room of the main dome, out on the shore of an alien sea. 7 of the others were sleeping. Lucky them. The rest were in the various lab modules, fighting the toxic biochemistry of the planet, trying to find a way to square the circle with poor, abused Earth biology. And then there was Lena and him. We can't get anywhere without samples, because when Lena said, we need to talk, she meant she needed to talk, to tell Bane what they all knew. I can't get samples if the damn things keep eating my drones. I need escorts, armed escorts. Drive off the locals. Don't call them locals. Bane's voice sounded like it had died, just a raspy croak. Just one particularly aggressive species, which is why I don't want to risk. They're just mollusks, Bane. They're not mollusks. They just look like a few of us in environment suits with guns. You're volunteering, are you? Too tired to be politic. Yes, I am, Lena confirmed. I will personally go out there with a hammer and crack open the next shellfish to try anything. Bane, we are besieged. You're being... There are dozens of the things within our immediate area. He felt sick. Not at the thought of marauding not mollusks, because even though they had a taste for drones, for some inexplicable reason, it wasn't as though the lumbering things had proved a threat, really. Sick because of the decisions hanging over him that he'd been resolutely refusing to make. I think we need to move site, he said weakly, knowing what her response would be. No! Bane, the coast is the only place where we found any give in the biology. You've seen the reports from the ship. It's all poison out there, utterly incompatible with Earth life. But the saltwater biomes, they're flexible. There's a convergence there. There are giant mollusks that eat our samplers. He waited for her to parrot his own not mollusks back at him. But she didn't. Abruptly, half the fight had gone from her, and she was looking away, to where the curved side of the dome met the hard plastic of the floor. They don't eat them, she said. Innocent enough, except there was a big, indigestible lump of words she wasn't quite vomiting up. Under the circumstances, and because he was so strung he couldn't think, he just let the silence hang. They... And she was just as worn down by the long shifts and drugs. We can't keep going. We should abandon this doomed venture and go back to the ship. Except Bane had heard what sort of measures the lead science team over there were considering and... Unthinkable. Just unthinkable. There must be another way. A path that preserves us as human. He realized he was crying. He couldn't stop it, and it didn't even engage with him consciously. It was just something his body was doing. Lena looked on dully. We did all the groundwork, some scientist part of him was wailing, outraged at an unfair universe. They had known there was a biosphere here they could work with, all the right elements, oxygen, carbon, plenty of water, life, recognisably the building blocks of life. It was supposed to be a paradise, ripe for colonising. Except, apparently, you could have every familiar Earth element and put them together in a way utterly inimical to anything from Earth. The world rejected them from their arrival and continued to do so, moment by moment. They couldn't eat it without being poisoned. They couldn't touch it without potentially fatal allergic reactions to everything. And they were here now. It wasn't a return trip. Hundreds of would-be colonists come light years from home, just to plant a flag in a planet that murdered them by its very nature. Fine, he spat out, because right then agreeing was less effort. Guns. Print out guns, ammunition. Something heavy enough to get through those shells. They were the size of a two-person transport, those not mollusks. Small arms fire or light energy weapons wouldn't stand a chance. Or a hammer, if you really want. And what can they do? Poor dumb beasts that they are. They were the Galapagos tortoises of an alien world, and they wouldn't even have the wit to rue the day they met humanity. Only after she'd gone, after he was back in his pod with strict instructions to shoot him full of downers and let him sleep for a week, did he realize he never asked her what they did with the sampler drones. What they did, instead of eating, that so discomforted her. But it was too late then, and by the time they woke him, it was a moot point. They were an unlovely thing, Lena Dow thought, but if they'd stuck to simply crawling about in the mud like the snails they resembled, she would have been content to share a world with them, at least until a solution was found to long-term human habitation there. If that solution involved snail genocide, she wouldn't weep. She might be a bioengineer, but that didn't mean she was soft on every creature in the cosmos. She'd come out with Shay Park and Arindo Snapper, geologist and technician respectively. They'd used too many expedition resources fabricating large bore percussion weapons, and now they were escorting a sampler drone out along the beach. They'd already seen a dozen of the monstrous mollusca-likes, even on the short walk from the dome complex to the sea. The sister colony expedition had set up in the wind shadow of a great rise, a slanted boulder 15 metres high that had been rolled up to the high watermark by some ancient storm, or perhaps left by retreating glaciation, though they'd seen little other sign of that. It remained the landscape's lone muck and vegetation-encrusted shelter, a bastion against the fierce winds that came off the great greenish expanse of the sea, the water murky as a weed-choked pond with the scum of plankton. Filthy. She wouldn't want to put a foot in it. Yet this ecosystem was the most amenable to conversion for human uses. Coming about the boulder hill's broad, rounded base, she felt her heart sink at the sight. The beach was utterly desolate, windswept with a strand line of decaying purple detritus, speckled with the odd corpse of some oceanic denizen. Not fish, not even not fish, as the snails were not snails. Macrofauna on this world had a kind of a skeleton, but no spine. The hydrodynamic shape that evolved over and over on Earth never found a foothold here. Everything that swam was all webbed legs, like spider crabs crossed with bats. And dead if it had washed up here. If she weren't suited up, she'd have a noseful of alien decay, a weirdly floral cloying scent, but a stink nonetheless. She reckoned they'd stink alive, too. She hated them, but not as much as the snails. They dominated the beach. She could see 30 of them, the smallest as large as she was, the largest 4 times that. They made their desultory way along the strand, picking over the detritus. Too big, too slow, too wrong. And they didn't care about her. She meant nothing to their creeping existence. Except they didn't even slide about like real snails. Beneath that crumpled, swept back cone of a shell, there were greyish legs, like fingers, as though the snail was a hand nestled into that great stony shell like an obscene hermit crab. Mostly they stayed low, and only the stumps of their fingertips were visible, broad about as Lena's thigh. But she'd seen them move. She'd seen the bastards hustle, from a standing start and without any obvious cause. They lifted their huge shells like ponderous matrons with their skirts, and those grotesque flesh limbs scuttled them along, far too fast for so huge a bulk. The sight had made her ill when they showed her the footage. She'd hated them ever since. But she didn't indulge herself. She just escorted the wheeled drone as it motored over to the strand line and began selecting another round of samples from the recently beached. Back at the dome, the expedition scientists, Lena included, would do their level best to find levers amongst this alien biochemistry, to find a way to yoke it to their service. Or clear it, said the quiet voice in the back of her mind. Exterminate it, just locally, just to give them a foothold. We came so far. Like Bane, she'd spoken to their counterparts at the ship. People were dying. The planet was killing them. All attempts at agriculture were stillborn. People were desperate. But Lena Dahl told herself that she thrived under pressure. It made her stronger. She fought back. The sampler drones. She didn't know what it was about the things, but the snails loved them. The expedition team had tried painting them different colors, modulating the engine frequency, signals, emissions. The monsters couldn't resist, no matter what. They came and dismantled them, devoured parts, not all, but only some components. Mechanisms, the computer brain, certain instruments, as though they were gourmets. She'd seen footage of that, too. The snails were hands within hands, unfolding rubbery mouth parts that were just rings of fingers over smaller fingers until the bile almost choked her.
Incoming,
Shay said, and, true to form, the closest snails had started ambling over. When they stayed low, she could almost kid herself that they were just mollusks.
Do we what? Give them a warning?
Arindo asked.
Sure. Go tack an eviction notice on them, Lena snapped.
Loud noises had been tried. No point in a warning shot. She looked around to see where the rest of the things were, because she didn't want to get mobbed, pawed at by those horrible, unformed hands. The rest of the beachcomber population were scattered all the way down the strand line, safe enough. She leveled the gun and shot. Recoil compensation meant little of the kinetic kickback got to her shoulder. The snail rocked, and she saw cracks craze the walled, stony curve of its shell. For a moment it was still, but then it just continued its dogged progress towards the sampler, intent on vandalism. I hope the others are capable of learning from this, she said, and gave it another round. The super-dense plastic projectile struck close on the crack and a great shard of shell was abruptly hanging away, still attached by sticky membranes and grey flesh to the thing beneath. Now the bastard stopped. Now it shuddered and its unspeakable finger legs drummed and clawed the gritty beach. Without being told, Shay and Arindo did the same to the second, three shots sufficing to shatter its defences and leave it split open and quivering. They were hollow, she saw. The first one had a mess of organic detritus inside it. The second, sampler parts. She stared. They'd been there a while, weirdly patinant, layered over as though becoming outsize alien pearls. For a moment, until she put another round into the mess, until she convinced herself otherwise and recast the memories a different way, she thought there had been an organization to the pieces, as though the insensate brute had filed them away according to some plan. Bane woke to find the world shaking. The lid of his pod had popped open. Evacuation protocols in full swing. Uncontrollable spasms racked his limbs under the chemical onslaught of the emergency wake-up procedure. He jackknifed up, almost fell face first out onto the floor. There were klaxons going, panicked voices. He heard gunfire.
What? What?
Croaking pitifully, alone in the sleep room. Above him, the curved ceiling shuddered. Still wearing a medical smock, he stumbled out into a corridor, almost going under the feet of three of his crew. He clawed at them.
What? What?
I'm the director. You have to tell me. Two of them just charged off. The third, unable to shake him off, stared wild-eyed.
We have to get out. What is it?
As though if he got three sentences of briefing, he could magically make it all go away, quell the earthquake. Repel the invasion.
Bane!
He jerked as his name was called, and the man he had hold of writhed out of his grip and ran. Turning, he saw Lena. She looked. She had a gun, and there was blood on her,
the sleeve of her exosuit torn up. "We're under attack, Bane," she barked. "Get to the flyer."
Attack?
For a moment, his mind just went into freeform. Attack from the other colonists? The planet? The sound of tortured metal from nearby shocked him out of it.
"We need to get you in a suit," Lena shouted at him. "Come on."
Behind her, the wall of the corridor deformed, something blunt shunting determinedly against it. There was a lab on the other side of that, and he had sudden thoughts of something grown there, some experiment gone wild. Lena had seen it too.
"They're inside already," she told him, hauling him away. "So we need to get out. Out and away. Back to the ship." This was a mistake. It was all a mistake.
Up to and including coming to colonize this planet in the first place, her tone said.
"They?"
Echoing her was all he could do.
"The snails." Impossible.
Even as he thought it, even as Lena dragged him off, he saw the corridor wall split behind them, the round, ridgy prow of a shell pushed through it, dragged forwards on those ghoulish, grey fingers. They got to the airlock, and Lena insisted on him suiting up, even though her own suit was torn open, her blood exposed to every alien particle that a body would so violently reject, even though someone had jammed the airlock doors open so people could flee. That brought it home. That made it real. We're abandoning the expedition. The whole base was contaminated by the planet now. They'd start to sicken soon, if the snails don't get us. The flyer was ahead. He saw people thronging there. One of the servitors, a 9-foot humanoid form of titanium and plastic, was patiently loading it with crates under Arindo Snapper's direction.
"I've got him,"
Lena was yelling. Her voice came dully to Bane through his helmet.
"Just get on board. Just..."
The snail came at them with manic speed. Surely a ton of shell and mushy body, but it was riding high, its rubbery hand of a body at full extension. People threw themselves aside, and the servitor was caught by the edge of the shell, flipped end over end with a squeal of complaining electronics. The sound of the creature ramming the flyer was weirdly flat. It didn't sound like the end of the world at all. If Lena had rapped on his faceplate, the noise would have been sharper, more alarming. And yet the machine folded, all those high-strength, hollow components just crumpling before the snail's unstoppable momentum. People were running. People were fleeing in all directions. He heard shots. One thundered from close by as Lena sent around into that shell, marking it with a jagged white scar. The creature crouched in the ruin of their flyer, their single transport, the only way they could get back to the ship. Its shell cocked and tilted, the rubbery legs beneath lifting it high as though it was exulting. It extruded a mass of prying fingers and began to tear into the ruined machine's innards. He heard Lena scream at it in fear and frustration. The ground shook again. He'd written it off as the structure of the base under assault, but he was out of the dome now. The ground was just the ground. Lena was pulling at his arm, but he just turned back to see. No amount of warning could have prevented him. The hill, the shielding boulder they'd built against, it was moving. Weed and mud at its base bulged and split as it levered itself up. He saw the vast limbs there, like the hand of a half-formed god. 1. As we made our way through the last of the trees towards Merivo, the children saw us. I think the adults sent them out that way, their scouts having had sight of us for a while. The little ones didn't know what was going on, and we heard their shrieking as they spotted us between the bristling, feathery trunks. An odd sound, part terror, part excitement. Half of them were too young to remember us the last time we came this way, but they heard stories. Children are their own secret order, with their own initiations, legends, and rites. The thought made our business seem innocent by association.
"The bandage men," they cried, and fled ahead of us. "Don't let them get you."
And I knew their parents must tell them, "Be good, do your share, or the bandage men will claim you." And it was true. We would. We'd become a part of their world in just 10 years. which before us had nothing new in it for many centuries, and that gives me hope. Things can change, which mean they can get better. Those children saw us as dread figures, terrors to scare them into being good. We were the bandage men, and they told each other tales about what lay beneath our wrappings, what wounds, what decay and deformity. Were we even alive, or just corpses, skeletons, beasts pretending to human shape? They could never know that when we take someone away to become part of our bandaged brotherhood, it is a mercy. It is better than the alternative. My name is Handry, and I am many things. To my home village of Arrow, which I have not seen for many, many years, I was an outcast, cut off from the rest of humanity after being daubed with the Severance, that mystical potion the Dr. Ghosts concoct when someone has been so bad that the village can no longer support them. Severed, you become no longer one of us, no longer a part of the world. All men's hands turned against you, all the fruits of the world poison in your mouth, and then, as it used to be, you die. Tsharskin the priest, who found me after my Severance, who took me to the house of our ancestors, I was a human of the original condition. He taught me that what had been severed from me was not my birthright, but an addition, an adaptation. He said what I was now, despised, rejected, was nonetheless the native state of a human being. And although he was wrong about so many things, in this he was correct. And he has been dead for many, many years too. But sometimes I hear his voice still. In my head, mostly, though occasionally the ancestors remember it and use it in their house to speak to me. To the other bandaged men, I am their leader, the new priest of the new doctrine who came after Tsharskin, and to them, we are not the bandaged men of the children's nightmares, but the Order of Cain. Simultaneously outcast and elevated, despised and necessary, we who can do things no other human can. And all we paid for the privilege was everything we had and ever were. To Mellory, I am just Handry, her brother. And what is Mellory to me? Sister, yes. Doctor, ghost-bearer, but more than that. Since unthroning Tsharskin, she has become something else. She is the sage who interprets the voices that throng the house. She commands the ancestors and curates the fragmentary knowledge they deliver. She is the bridge between the villages and the Order, because although she commands the ancestors who shelter and feed us, she is not one of us. She is the one who never abandoned me. As we made our final approach to Merivo, we started the music. A few of us had pipes to blow into, tuneless but piercing. I have lived with the music for years, and it still scrapes about the inside of my head. Some had rassels of stones and gourds and bones. The rest had bells, just tubes hung from a string that we struck with stones. The tubes were metal, though, and metal was something the people of Merivo had no experience of, not a part of their world. The high, ringing tones of our bells, echoing out between the trees, told them something unnatural was drawing near. The bandage men were coming to take their due. And they would be rushing about, making their own preparations. There was a compact between the Order and those villages that accepted us, which were more than the villages that didn't these days. It had been a long road, 10 years, and I'm not the child I was when Tsharskin found me starving in Orovo, and the villages would not have accepted that child, nor the man he grew into, but they would accept the bandage men. Back then, after I became the priest and Mellory the sage, back then when those of the Order who had not fled accepted the way things were, back then we tried, Mellory and I, just to go to the villages, to explain to them how it was and that outcasts like me and the others were just people.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.